Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. The Mobil Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
Years ago, it was quite widely assumed that centripetal pressures were finally bringing together, however grudgingly, the nations of Europe. When the common market was established, hopes ran especially high. Today, it is the conclusion of most people, or at least the conclusion of Luigi Barzini, that Europe is further away from unification than at any time since 1815. We are here to ask why. Can anything be done about it? And if you promise not to tell, we are here primarily to enjoy the company of Luigi Barzini, whose new book, The Europeans, leaves the reader caring more that Barzini should survive than that Europe should do so. Mr. Barzini was born in Milan, but came to college at the Columbia University, where he attended the School of Journalism, returning to Italy to work for Corriere della Sera, the most prestigious Italian newspaper, which, by the way, has recently got into very hot water. He covered every major diplomatic and political event of the 30s and was cast into jail for his anti-fascist views and activity, and in due course was liberated by the American army. He went back to journalism by publishing and editing two dailies, and then he wrote his masterwork, The Italians, which tells more than 100 rivals what Italy is all about, including here and there, however discreetly, what Italy should be all about. In the current volume, Mr. Barzini deals with the Americans and Italy, of course, and Germany and England, France and Holland. Our examiner, about whom more in due course, is Mr. James Chase, the managing editor of Foreign Affairs. In one passage in his book, Mr. Barzini remarks, "The United States cannot afford to make mistakes today." I'd like to begin by asking him, why should this be so? And in fact, haven't we made such mistakes?
Well, I didn't say you don't make mistakes. I said you couldn't afford to. And as a matter of fact, you are now the most powerful, important, influential country in the world. One of your mistakes can drag us all down the drain to ruination. While in the old days, when you were a small republic on the border of the Atlantic, you could make mistakes. You could do anything you wanted because that your mistakes did not change the face of the world.
Or would you specify what might be some mistakes that we might very easily make which fall into that apocalyptic category?
Well, to lose patience negotiating with the Russians, lose patience negotiating with the European allies, withdraw your troops from Germany, or there are a thousand possibilities of mistakes. I think what you have to fight against is your impatience. You want to see things settled. A friend of ours, a friend of yours and mine, veteran American journalist, came to see me once in Rome. And he wanted the solution of Italian problems immediately, next day. And I was a bit perturbed, and I said, and how to defeat the communist menace? And I said, if you were in Constantinople and you asked the emperor of Byzantium, how do you defeat the Turks? Well, maybe the Turks win. And you don't solve a problem which takes perhaps a generation. You can't do it in the morning, the next morning.
Well, that's of course, it is correct that we are achievement oriented, which is one of the reasons why we tend to lose 100-year wars. the American soldier who first saw a cricket match and commented, that he could understand how it was that the English had won the Hundred Years' War, which, by the way, they didn't, did they? But is there any way in which, given this knowledge of America, this lack of patience can be compensated for?
I don't know, because I have no idea where this lack of patience comes from. I have discussed the matter once with Walter Lippmann, and we tried to invent reasons why Americans could not bear to see a problem unsolved. It had to be solved and solved it quickly. And I tried to expose a hypothesis of mine. Maybe your span, the ideal of your life is limited to one man's life, to one generation, while you want to see results before you die. While in Europe, the thing is slower. People think that maybe my son will achieve something. Maybe my grandson will get there. My great-grandson will arrive where the whole family has tried to arrive. And in your country, the family has lost some of its ancient value. Let's say the Jews, the Italians, the Chinese think in terms of generations and family. You think in terms of your generation before you die.
Well, you say of Americans that they tend to think of the contemporary generation, that it's all that in fact matters. Now, what is the implication of that weakness on foreign policy insofar as it is a debilitating impact?
Well, I would say that foreign policy as conceived in Europe was slow, unless there is an imminent crisis, was a slow approach to certain goals. The British had a little naval base in an inconspicuous part of Africa and then another naval coaling station somewhere else. And all this made a slow pattern, and allies and friends. And this the Americans are too impatient to do. They do it, they try to do it, but they always try to do the things on the basis of the morning paper. What happened yesterday? Then they rush Mr. Kissinger, Mr. Schultz to the Near East. They talk in one day with one day with the other. They won't see results. I would like to see results myself within a day or two. But these things work themselves out very slowly. You know, the Europeans think of three tools are useful to for solving foreign affairs problems. One of them is the balance of power. One of them is secret diplomacy, and the third is la raison d'etat. Now, these three things are considered obscene words in the United States. A balance of power is a non-American thing. La raison d'etat is in Europe. For the raison d'etat, Nixon would have been saved. He was the head of the West. You couldn't expose him. You couldn't discredit him. Maybe you were right to do differently. I'm merely pointing out the difference between the Americans and the Europeans. And secret diplomacy. At the end, you had to recur to secret diplomacy, too, as if you, too, were Europeans, which you are, after all.
Well, the need for secret diplomacy was stressed in the Federalist Papers.
Yes, of course.
But on this program a few years ago, Harold Macmillan making the point that things happen faster now than they did in traditional Europe, said, when I was a young man working for the Foreign Office, it took about exactly as long to send a courier to Rome as it took Julius Caesar to send one to England 2,000 years earlier. Now, in my lifetime, that trip of 2.5 days has been reduced to 2.5 hours. Now, are there implications for that, for instance, on the matter of the unification of Europe? Do these high stresses mean that those ancient rhythms are no longer entirely useful?
I have, of course you're right, the crises appear overnight nowadays and you have to take quick decisions. And in that case, the Americans are in their natural field. But I end the British chapter, the imperturbable English, with a description of what Roberto Ducci, who was Italian ambassador in London for a long time, told me when he went to see the British foreign secretary. It would illustrate the fact that there was an imminent crisis and the decision had to be taken. He could see the foreign secretary look at him with glassy eyes and thinking, here's an excitable southerner. He thinks there is a crisis. The crisis does not exist, or maybe it isn't as serious as he thinks. So that it was always very difficult to push the English into some quick decision. And while the Americans are the opposite, they really are sometimes too quick.
And now, can you give us a recent example of that?
American,
yeah.
Like in, I don't know, not recent, but you menaced quick decisions, withdrawing troops from America, warring on, there was a letter on the, in the New York Times when the price of oil was raised that you would, some professor suggested that it was time for the Americans to conquer Saudi Arabia, whatever.
Robert Tucker. Yeah, he didn't quite say that, but he suggested that there were circumstances under which it might become necessary.
Well, that's it, you see, and but in the past, how many times you've landed Marines in San Domingo, and perhaps a little more savoir-faire would have solved the problem. Mm-hmm.
Well, of course, there wasn't quite enough savoir-faire in Europe to prevent two world wars recently, was there?
I'm not. I say repeatedly that what the Europeans can contribute is the wealth of their past errors, mm-hmm. of their stupid wars, mm-hmm. of their senseless convulsions and revolutions.
You talk about the distinctive contributions of individual countries to what we know of as Europe. And then you come out in a passage I had written down here, now don't have, in saying that, in fact, the time has come when they must surrender political authority, when they must have a common currency. And so, now, what makes you, on the one hand, urge this for paradigmatic reasons, and on the other hand, say so gloomily that it is not so unlikely to happen?
You are a doctor, you see a sick man, mm-hmm. and you say, this man is sick, these are the symptoms.
You say, this man should stop smoking.
Yeah, he should stop smoking. And then you turn around and you say, now, if he were healthy, mm-hmm. as he will be if he follows my suggestions, this is the way he would be. Mm-hmm. This is what I'm saying.
Yes, but you're not writing a book in the sense of Thomas More's Utopia.
No.
You're writing a book about a Europe that you know marvelously well, and therefore, you're really trying to push, aren't you?
Well, I do not hide my desires, but I'm not pushing. There is no pushing to be done. You can't push Europe. You can't push the French. The French have been that way since the Middle Ages. Heine called them the Gascogne of Europe, France. And they are very touchy on their language, their wine. They even call Italian dishes with French names, the ravioli, la niçoise, and just not to admit that they are using somebody else's food, or choucroute à l'alsacienne.
They have 5 o'clock tea.
Yes.
So, well, the Algerians pushed them around a little bit, didn't they?
Yes, but they never really diminished their self-confidence. Well, the Germans pushed them around a lot, too, for that matter. But they always rise again with, mind you, they have all the reasons to be proud. I am a great admirer of France. If you read my pages mm-hmm. on France, I find them a little hard to live with, but I admire them from a certain distance. Mm-hmm.
You had a nice passage in that section on France, in which Schumann and Monet, and who was the third?
No, it was De Gasperi, Schumann, and Adenauer.
Talking in French.
talking German. They were all
that's
three.
Right, that's right, that's
all
right,
three
right.
had
that's
studied. Right. Yeah, Schumann right. had studied in Bavaria.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Adenauer, of course, was German. Mm-hmm. And De Gasperi was born a subject of Franz Josef, Emperor of Austria, mm-hmm. Hungary. And he had studied in Innsbruck.
All Catholic.
All Catholic, mm-hmm. all German speakers, all marginal people of their own nations. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Adenauer was a Western German, which is not a complete German as we conceive Germans. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. De Gasperi was Trentino, way up in the north in the Alps, born under the Austrians. Schumann was Alsatian with a German name and German education.
Well, but those were three people, each of whom you characterized very warmly, who had a sense of
Europe. A sense of Europe.
A sense of Europe. Mm-hmm. Now, why didn't that sense of Europe reify in the 15 years since they died?
Well, the illusion after the war was that Europe could be compared to a stagecoach in which there were six horses that somehow trotted in the same direction, one next to the other, but were not tied to anything. Mm-hmm. So that if you looked at the stagecoach going by, you had the impression that there was a stagecoach and there were six horses pulling it. They weren't. They drifted in all directions as soon as they could. And so that what there is now of Europe is no longer the dream of Monet, the dream of everybody from Dante to Briand, Victor Hugo, Garibaldi, everybody. Even Napoleon dreamt of a united Europe. Talleyrand.
He practically affected it.
Well, he did place some of members of his family in various thrones, but he never settled in a united Europe. And so that this great dream, which was called Christendom in the Middle Ages, which brought the fleets of Europe, Western Europe, against the Turks at Lepanto, which brought at Poitiers the French Charles Martel against the Arabs. And the anonymous chroniclers of Poitiers in Latin call the men fighting against the Arabs, they don't call them the Christians. They call them the Europeans. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So that this is an immense ancient dream. We feel, many of us, perhaps the majority of us, feel that it's silly to have borders. It's silly to call each other different names. We should have one common foreign policy, one common defense policy, one currency, and one financial policy.
You speculate on what would have happened in America if there had not been this war of independence, which in fact caused this unification that might otherwise not have happened, right?
Well, the War of Independence, of course, helped. The real help was the Constitution, which was a handiwork of George Washington, a small number of men, that made the United States one solid body. But then the comparison is impossible. The inhabitants of the American colonies were English citizens, subjects with the tradition of the defense of the individual liberty. They had a common language. They had a common culture, especially the elite. They had studied, they had read, they knew Hobbes, they knew Locke, they knew French, they knew Latin. Jefferson and the others were very cultivated gentlemen of a uniform type, and the times were ripe. It was the Age of Enlightenment. America was the first exemplification of the ideas of that century. While Europe, everybody's a different kind of thing. We all have different histories. I feel European, but then we are very attached to each to his own past. And that is perhaps the greatest difficulty. You think, when you put them all around the table, they're all empires, ex-empires. It's like a club of decayed noblemen. Nobody wants to give up its prestige, its prerogatives, its grandeur. the memory of its grandeur. Some of the European countries are three empires. Take the French, is Napoleon the First, Napoleon the Third, and l'Empire Colonial. Then you take the Germans, they had one Reich, second Reich, and third Reich. You take when Portugal enters the common market, we will have the Portuguese Empire. It goes as far as Goa, Macau in China. Or you take the Spanish, the sun never sets. You take the Greeks, it's Byzantium and the Empire, Roman Empire of the East. So it's very difficult to get these people to think of a condominium in which everybody is a prince, a duke, a king, or something. It's very difficult to get them to decide the price of fuel oil for heating the apartments.
Well, let's examine some of the pressures that work in both directions. You make a reference to the diminishing fear of the Soviet Union on the assumption, of course, that the fear of the Soviet Union was a welding agent 25 years ago. Now, why is that fear diminishing given the strides the Soviet Union has made along military lines and therefore the corollary capacity to intimidate?
Well, that's a question I posed myself. I went all the way to Germany and explored the defenses of Western Germany, talked to staff officers, and tried to understand. To begin with, they said, I'm making it very short, they said that this megalomaniac piling up of men, armaments, tanks, transport, is beyond the limits of reasonable military technique. Because should all this move forward in an offensive against Western Europe, the roads and the railroads behind them are not sufficient to supply them with what is necessary in battle. So the deduction is that this is a psychological threat rather than a real military threat. Why is it psychological? To begin with, the Russians can't stop building armaments. The priority goes since 1933, the priority went to heavy industry. And the armament industry is one of the heavy industry sections. The military are the strongest lobby power group in the Soviet Union. To stop building tanks or guns or whatnot would provoke a bureaucratic revolution, which is unthinkable. Then there is another thing. Why should the Russians want Europe? Well, they want Europe because with the domination of Europe, they would have the domination of the world, the hegemony on the world, the whole world. And but what Europe do they need? They need Europe as is, intact, with its scientists, its professors, its bankers, its industrialists, its technicians, it's everything. And if they start fighting, of course, what they get is mounds of radioactive rubble and fluorescent corpses, but that's not Europe. Not only they need Europe as is, but Europe free, as Finland was, still is. Because if Europe were imprisoned within the bonds of Marxist-Leninist dogmas, it would turn into a large Czechoslovakia, which has no life of its own, it has no initiatives, it has no importance.
So therefore you would judge Soviet objectives ultimately to limit themselves primarily to killing NATO, evacuating American troops,
scaring Europe.
Dictating economic terms, credit, and that kind of stuff.
And forcing Europe to accept a certain Russian leadership in international affairs. Mm-hmm. And so it is a psychological weapon, mostly.
And how mature would you say that weapon is?
Well, How mature? Well, I don't know if it's ripeness is all in this field, but I would say that if Russians wanted to conquer Europe with a war, they would have done it years ago when Europe was really still disarmed. They would do it tomorrow morning before the Americans have prepared and set down in Europe all the new weaponry they are thinking of. They don't seem to be willing to start a war tomorrow morning. They could, you know, because they are now in a condition to start the war by telex. They have their tanks are loaded with ammunition and fuel. Everything is ready, the men are ready, so that only one word by telex would start the war. But they don't seem to be that wanting to do it. It's a psychological threat.
Well, does their decision not to, in your judgment, rest to a considerable extent on their evaluation of what would be the American response and therefore
exactly.
on the evaluation of the character of the American president?
Exactly.
And wouldn't you guess that they simply wouldn't take a chance of doing this while Ronald Reagan was president?
I would say that any American president would have thrown the first nuclear bomb in case Western Europe was going down. Of course, this is a very difficult question, because if you question officers who are interested in this problem and you say, I doubt that the first atomic weapon will be really tossed in case of war, then they all shout you down, because peace depends on the belief that a bomb will be thrown. But you and I are not staff officers. We don't wear ranks. We can speak freely. And there is a doubt that the atomic weapon will be like gas in the previous war. That's the last minute. Somebody will have doubts about recourse to such terrifying means. The deduction from that is that Europe should build up conventional forces. But conventional forces are expensive. A missile, you put it in a hole in the ground and there it is. It costs millions, but the upkeep is easy and it's always ready. While men have to eat, the men have to be clothed, men have to be instructed, their vehicles deteriorate, have to be repaired, renovated, their tanks have to be rebuilt because they become obsolete, and so on. So that this is what I dislike, is the reluctance of Europeans to accept the burden of defending themselves with conventional weapons. After all, the enemy in front of them is a conventional enemy, first of all.
How would Europeans react to the recent declaration by the American bishops that it would be wrong under any circumstances to initiate a nuclear war, by which it is commonly understood that the bishops intend to join those others who have said that even if the Soviet Union were to move massively with tactical arms, the West would not be justified in using tactical nuclear arms to resist them?
Well, that's the point I just made.
I know. I say, how would the Europeans react to this?
The Europeans should react. I don't know how they would react. They probably go back to bed. But
you mean that it doesn't interest them, whatever?
No, well, they are. You know what de Gaulle said about the French? He said, il faut payer pour être la France. You must pay to be France. Mm-hmm. Well, you must pay to be Europe. Pay in young man's years serve in the service of their country in uniform. You must prepare conventional defenses adequate to what is facing them. And this costs money. And it's too easy to say, let the Americans' atomic bomb decide everything. I think it is not worthy of centuries of civilization.
But Ms. Barzini, you switched from what Europe ought to do to what Europe is in fact doing and is in fact going to do.
Well,
now, you and I both know that that we have been trying to get them to rearm tactically since the days of Dean Acheson,
yes,
and they have done it. Now, they're not likely to do it tomorrow, so I'm asking, what is the impact of an Episcopal statement of this kind of weight on people over there who have been listless? Will they in fact go back to bed? Or will they say, here is something that's alarming, we should perhaps look after our impoverished tactical cupboard?
Well, the answer, of course, is in your question. The Europeans are not going to do anything. But they have been increasing. The Italians, for instance, have been increasing by 3% their defense budget. And this is a great forward step for a country. And every European country, except Germany, has decreased somewhat their expenses, but they had been among the best Europeans. Their defenses are first class. They have an army better than what Hitler had in his days. But I think this is the first step, that Europeans should be convinced. And they are not convinced now. That's what you would like me to say. Well, they're not. They're just nicely drinking beer in gardens, listening to band music, eating gelati, worrying about their jobs. They're not really worried about a war.
Is this something that you think of as in character with recent European history?
I don't know. I don't think so, because only recently some of the European countries have shown military qualities, including the Germans, which were extraordinary, the British and the Germans and the Americans, if we include the Americans among the Europeans. But and then it isn't true, I don't think, that the Europeans have become too refined, too gamey, to do the necessary job of defending their continent. There are very rough people among us, you know Europe as well as I do, and to think everybody is a little Proust in Europe or Raffiné, something or other, it's an exaggeration.
Yeah. We I hate to try to conquer Switzerland.
Yes. Well, we have tough people in Europe.
Yeah.
And we could fight. What is lacking is the pride in their past, in the moral and cultural values to defend. There is some spring that is broken somewhere. Probably an excessive prosperity, but the gains of the last 40 years, I don't really know. I don't think Europeans are going to listen to me. Nobody has ever listened to me, incidentally.
Well, let's both of us listen to our examiner, Mr. James Chase, who, as I say, is the managing editor of Foreign Affairs. Mr. Chase is a graduate of Harvard, who studied also in Paris, who has taught at Columbia and at Yale. And speaking of the remilitarization of Europe, he also most recently wrote a book called Solvency, The Price of Survival, Mr. Chase.
Gentlemen, well, listening to you, the conversation seemed to have taken a rather different tone than it did from the beginning. At first, it seemed it was a sort of tone of complacency. Americans are too impatient. We should relax a bit, reminded of Talleyrand's remark to a foreign service officer, surtout pas trop de zèle, let's not get too zealous. Nonetheless, sometimes there are crises which are less evident, but nonetheless quite serious. And you speak, I think, rather more seriously in the book than you have here, at least, on the German question, the German problem, the problem, in fact, of the unification of Germany, and this is an ideal which the Germans still very much hold. And Germany, and it is precisely the question of the place, role of Germany in Europe that has probably caused a more serious wars and troubles for the last 100 years than anything else one can think of. Well, what I worry about, and I wonder how you both feel about this, is that if there's no European unity in prospect, because, in part at least, of the problem of settling German reunification, how can, in other words, can you have unity without of Europe without unity of Germany? Do you think then that the Germans might try to seek unity through an understanding with the Soviet Union, a neutral solution? They were unable to find unity earlier, as you point out, Signor Barzini, through the enormous American buildup at the end of the war, which they believed might give them back their eastern zone, and indeed perhaps some closer connections to East Central Europe. But what if the Germans lose confidence in the American military guarantee? What if they lose confidence in the American nuclear guarantee? In short, when you have a period today where the Soviet Union and the United States find themselves in a period of rough nuclear parity or equality, are the Germans saying, will the United States risk the destruction of Wichita for Stuttgart? And what does that imply?
What you say is in my book. So much so that the book is coming out in Germany with the title, The Future of Europe is in the Hands of Germany. And I point out that it is not mentioned by anybody and denied by the Germans, officially and unofficially in private conversation, that the problem of reunification of Germany is a serious one. It is a serious one. No country can live divided. But, and you are absolutely right, in the future, someday, in the right circumstances, a right offer by the Russians might ease the possibilities of reunification of all Germans under one state. Yes, this is a hypothesis, and perhaps one of the reasons why the Europeans do not integrate. That to integrate means to be wedded to the German problem, to have their future decided, not today, not tomorrow, perhaps 20 years from now, by some German decision. And as I point out, Germany is Proteus. Germany changes shape, character, and is most dangerous when it is unhappy. This is the end of the book. So that, yes, one of the reasons the Europeans do not integrate is the fear that one day, eventually, and God help us, may not happen at all, Germany will be tempted into selling part of its soul in exchange for reunification. In that case, we are all in it, and then all of Europe is Finlandized. That we do not want.
But is this like it happened, Mr. Buckley, because they may be losing confidence in the United States guarantee?
Well, I myself think, Mr. Chase, that what happens in the next few months is absolutely critical. Here we are, as a lot of people have forgotten, at the specific request of a social democratic Western, a Western social democratic government of Germany, going down to put in our Pershing 2s and our cruise missiles in order realistically to attempt to balance the military situation in that quarter. If we back down from that as a result of American or American cum-European pressure, then I should think bright establishmentarians in Germany might start to think along the lines that you sketch, i.e., well, since we're not going to get the kind of security we bargained for, maybe we can do something to get East Germany in, even if it requires kicking out the Americans. So I should think that that démarche is, of all that I have thought of, is the likeliest over the period of the next 3 or 4 years.
Nevertheless, we are stressing the question of whether the United States will emplace the missiles. We haven't talked really about the other side of that coin, which is the possibility of arms control agreements with the Soviet Union and the overall implication. And this, again, seems to me an important question that I'd be interested in both of your views on. It's a question of consistency. How can the Europeans count on American consistency when we essentially repudiated an arms control agreement that was concluded between President Ford and President Brezhnev, Vladivostok, President Carter, if he didn't repudiate it, but he certainly put it aside so profoundly as to start a different initiative which didn't go anywhere with Secretary Vance. Finally, 4 years later, he concludes another agreement, not that different, from my view, from what he had in the first place with Kissinger and Brezhnev. That, in turn, was set aside by this administration as well as the last, and we begin yet another round of arms control. Now, let us assume for a moment that, in fact, we come to some form of agreement. How can the Europeans believe that once again another administration would not, if not repudiate, virtually repudiate that agreement? So is this kind of foreign policy, which seems to be very, very inconsistent, one that would give the Europeans any confidence in the United States?
I quote Helmut Schmidt as saying, and he said it in front of me, he said, the Americans are what they are, but they are the only Americans we have. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's the answer to your question. Suppose the Americans renege the pact they had signed. Well, that's part of the possible eventualities. You have to navigate with whatever winds there are, as you, Bill Buckley, know very well. You have to change your course if you have a storm ahead.
It would make the Europeans feel at home, wouldn't it?
With it, very much. And we've always done these things, mm-hmm. and this will happen. So we have to have do the things we have to do soberly and wait for the best. And of course, the Americans do not change their minds very often, as you suggest.
Well, they may not change their minds so very often, but nonetheless, there is a question of the kind of foreign policy which does have long-range staying power. I think that you yourself quoted Henry Kissinger in your book as saying that American foreign policy fluctuates between euphoria and panic. I wonder, Mr. Buckley, what period would you say we're in now?
Well, I think we're heading back in the direction of euphoria. I don't think we ever panicked. When we declined to ratify SALT II, it was on the grounds that it was too heavily based on romance, and that our experience with SALT I was an experience that saw us 10 years later, not with a diminution in the strategic reserves of both of the superpowers, but a 300% increase in Soviet megatonnage and a 100% increase in our own. So people looked at SALT II with the kind of skepticism they had earned from the experience of SALT I, and argued against it. Now, right now, I think, as you suggest, we are working our way back from that period, not of panic, I would say, so much as of suspicion. I think going too far in the other direction.
But haven't we frightened the Europeans, Signor Barzini, when we've talked about the possibility of fighting a limited nuclear war in Europe? Hasn't President Reagan frightened them?
Well, yes, of course. Kissinger contributed mightily to frightening the Europeans when he said that no American president would sacrifice an American city for the sake of defending Dusseldorf or any other European city. Yes, the Europeans are troubled, and but I would say, in defense of America, that the change of mind is due to the fact that Americans have developed a new strategy and a new conception of the use of atomic weapons, and that the old pacts were based on the threat of total annihilation. And now there is a more sober concept about what could be done and what should be done. I think what should be done, but I'm not the president of the Italian Council of Ministers, is, as I said before, reinforcing conventional weapons and armaments and the preparation of man, so that the absolute necessity of throwing the first atomic weapon should be diminished.
Well, in short, what you're asking for is something which no one seems to be willing to do in Europe, and I'm not sure they are in this country either, which is to make certain sacrifices.
I'm asking for sacrifices proportionate to the value of the things we want to defend.
Therefore, no
and
one feels.
I point out that it's only a question of money, because it's not a question of the willingness of young men to serve in the army. They've all, Europeans still, we have the draft, the French have the draft. We all served in the army. I myself was a bersagliere. But we take it for granted. And it's, as you pay taxes, you give a year, 2 years to your government, to your state, to your nation, in dressed in uniform. It's
not the British.
Not the British, no, but the French, the Italians, the Swiss are even worse than all of us. They're always in uniform.
Well, what I think, though, that if we talk, that if people are unwilling to make sacrifices, which are economic sacrifices.
Well, no. If the politicians are afraid of asking the people to make sacrifices, I believe if the thing were explained clearly, the people would say yes.
Fair enough.
But we have weak politicians who are afraid that the next election they will lose a few votes. That's probably the problem is there.
Well, that may very well be true. Certainly the age of giants, with the death of De Gaulle, seems to have been over.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, if the Europeans are fearful of the United States' consistency, if the Europeans worry about America, as you point out in the book, they do. And if they are worried about the Soviet Union, then of course the logic would be unity. But the only unity you ever seem to get in Europe has been when there's been an external threat perceived. Therefore, if there's no movement towards unity, then one assumes that they do not feel there's an external threat from the Soviet Union. Perhaps, on the other hand, they may feel there's a threat from the United States, that we will act too impetuously.
I'm afraid that the decision to be against the United States would be opposed by practically every European, because you think of the United States as a world apart across a vast ocean. I think of the United States as a European country, just as I think Europe today is becoming more and more an American appendage. We are one thing. I don't think we will ever accept unity against the United States. Unity has come, I have talked about this with all the experts in Brussels and Rome and Paris and London. Unity can come through a war, and a war is impossible. It's inconceivable. Unity of Europe can come through the rise of a great man, Charlemagne, let's say John Paul II, in civilian clothes, a charismatic personality of that caliber who can appear in a square and gather millions of people. And I haven't seen anybody in Europe that has that capacity in the political field as compared to the religious field. So a great crisis, the world depression, that might unite Europe. On the other hand, when the depression appeared in the last few years, every European nation tried to defend its own little private prosperity. So it didn't produce a unification. I do not know the answer. We have no answer. The only answer my book contains is that the young people are naturaliter Europeans. My sons, they speak every language. I have a son who works in London. Other young people go to France, go to England, go to Germany. They make love with each other, with the girls or the boys of the other countries. They marry foreign girls. Children grow up that speak two, three languages, the language of papa, the language of mama, and the language of the country they're living in. And this formation, a spontaneous formation of millions of Europeans who don't think of themselves as first of all, French, German, Italians, or Dutch, or Belgian, but think of themselves as Europeans. This is a very slow process. It's a coral-like formation, as I point out, but maybe a more solid approach to the solution of the problem of European integration, more durable than pieces of paper signed by diplomats and the statesmen with the fanfare of the press and so on. I think that that Europe, if we have peace in the next generation or so, will be a fait accompli against which there will be very little to be done.
Well, surely the Europe that you sketch out, which is a very rosy picture indeed, and I think it's undoubtedly true.
You've been there. You know it's true.
Sure, the among the young people, there's no question about it. One might also say that the Americanization of the world has also occurred through Europe. I mean, the same blue jeans, the same rock music. It's not like before the Second World War.
Jogging like President Carter.
But if the young are the hope of Europe, then I wonder, wouldn't you state in the book, why, though, that the young people, these people whom you feel are the hope of Europe, see the United States rather than the Soviet Union as the enemy. How do you explain that?
I don't say that.
Well, it's not per se, but it's the implication of what
I didn't say
I'm having got the quote that came out.
It's a very long and difficult problem. The United States is, in a way, the vanguard in the 20th century. Gertrude Stein said the oldest nation in the 20th century. So that, let's say, when I was here as a boy, my father would say with great certainty, Americans love to eat tin food. Now, tin food then was frozen food today. And I would say, Papa, Americans like to have a fat French cook in the kitchen who would prepare splendid meals. But the conditions of life in an industrialized, urbanized society makes it almost impossible. The mother has a job, the children come from school, she's got to rush to a shop to buy a few things, and the tin food is sometimes the only solution available, and frozen food today or whatever, junk food or whatever it is. And the Europeans always look down on the Americans as liking this kind of thing. The Americans are the first victim of the common civilization of us all. You are the first to face the problems, and we think the Americans are slightly demented. Look what they eat, look at how they live. They do without a butler, a cook, or a maid. They don't know how to live. But the problem is we are all in the same, we are all undergoing the same process of transformation of life. Italy itself, we have no more cooks, we have no more servants.
You know, when you stretch out this view,
So the young, when they say we don't like America, not the young especially, but the masses of newly recruited workers from the countryside, they've been uprooted from century-old traditions, a way of living, the recipe of the grandmother's way of cooking beans, I don't know. And they went by the calendar, the sunshine, the seasons, and they are very unhappy. But so were your farmers when they became industrialists, beginning of the century, end of the past century. This is the trauma of transformation of life. And the guilty, the symbol of this is the United States, not because America is responsible for all this, but because America is the oldest nation in the 20th century. She has gone through all this before. When you talk about violence, in France and Italy, think of your violence when you were undergoing the same transformation from a predominantly agrarian society to an industrialized society. For instance, the Molly Maguires, you being Irish, should remember them, and the IWWs, there were bombs thrown in the United States, people killed in this country long ago. No, America is not hated. America is resented sometimes as the symbol, most visible symbol, of this unacceptable transformation. On the other hand, the people want the fruits of the industrial society. They want the car, the vacations, the easy
dishwashers
and everything. They don't want the discipline, the dreariness, the boredom of industrial production in the 20th century.
We had an Atlantic Alliance.
We have 30 seconds.
Very briefly then. We had an Atlantic Alliance which began 30-odd years ago. It has stayed in place. Will it remain as it is? Will it remain with 300,000 American troops in Europe? In short, will the Europeans go on letting the United States essentially take care of the security of Europe?
That's, are you asking
for
me to forecast the future?
Why
I can
not?
Only express my wish. I wish the Europeans could say to the Americans, just leave a token body of troops here, and we'll think of our own defense.
And you can
help.
Tell them also, Mr. Barzini, to read your book, The Europeans, and come to their own conclusions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. James Chase of Foreign Affairs. Thank you, ladies of Paramus Catholic High School.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. The Mobil Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.